Partridge here, and today we're going to do a video that you guys have all been asking for, which is sort of about bitless bridles and bits and kind of what my opinions are on it. There are so many different types, so I'm going to kind of go through a bunch of the different types and why I use different ones on different horses. I've got Dreamer here, he's one of my Western horses. This is Blizz, she was one of my 2017 Thoroughbred Makeover horses. She's one of my English horses for jumping. So we're going to take a look and I'm going to tell you a little bit about all the different options. So for starters, we've got our bits. And bits, they obviously come in many different types. If I'm going to use a bit, I like to use one like this. This is a Mylar bit and it's got a little port in it. I hate snaffle bits, which is kind of contrary to a lot of trainers because a lot of people start horses in snaffle bits. What I like about this is that if you pull on it, it doesn't fold in half and hit the horse in the top of their mouth. If you use a snaffle, when you pull back, it folds in half, hits the horse in the top of the mouth, and they end up opening their mouth. That's why people usually put a nose band on them. So if I'm going to use a bit, I use something like this. And really right now, the only horse in my training program that I'm using a bit is Dreamer. And the big reason for that is that he had training before he came to me. He had reining training. And I'm doing some Western dressage, and I'm doing some extreme cowboy stuff. And I figure, even if I ride in bitless, which I do sometimes, and Franny actually competes in bitless, people are gonna say, oh, well, he was trained in a bit first. That's what I hear all the time is, oh, you have to train them in a bit first so they can go bitless, or the only reason they can do those things is because they've gone with a bit first. So I figure there's no point and really riding bitless for him because everybody's gonna say it doesn't matter because he was trained with a bit first. And I figure I may as well ride one horse in a bit so at least I can show that I can do it and I have soft hands. So really that's the only reason why I ride in a bit. And when I ride him, I ride with no nose band so that way if I am pulling too hard, he can open his mouth and you can see that that's what I'm doing. So that's a bit for you. And then I'm going to talk a little bit more in detail about some of these guys, but I'm just going to show them to you. So this is the Fusion halter. So this is a very basic side pull design. It's a halter, and it's got the rings on either side to attach the reins. Tried one of those. This is a leather side pull, so it's got the rings on the sides as well. We try those. This is another type of side pull really common in training horses. It's got rawhide across the top of the nose. We've tried those. This is a normal sort of hackamore with the shanks on it. This is an English like jumping style hackamore. When you pull back, it closes a little bit, like the chin piece, depending on how tight you have it and how long the shanks are. It closes a little bit, but not super tight. So we use those sometimes here. I've got a flower hackamore, which is very similar, but it's got different options of where you can put the reins, depending on if you want to have leverage or not. So we use those. We've also got Balzals here, and we've used these sometimes too. Now my favorites are using side pulls where it just has the action on the side, and you might notice that one of the things that I haven't shown you is one of the cross-under style bitless bridles, like the Dr. Cook's. And the reason why I don't have one of those is because I don't like using them. I don't like using the cross-under action. I have tried one before, it's just not for me. So I'm gonna focus on the other types of bitless bridles here. So we're just going to take a little look at the different types of bitless bridles and why you might want to choose one over another. So this is a Balzal. This is a pretty common bitless option for Western riders. It actually gives you very little control. So I don't actually know why a lot of people will start horses in them for a bitless option. Any sort of bitless attachment where it goes under their chin, you're going to have less control or less options for what you can do with a horse if they're running off on you or things like that in terms of doing your emergency stops. And that's because it all comes from underneath there. So if I'm going along and I want to do an emergency stop, so that I'll start a lot of horses or I do a lot of thoroughbreds, if they're running off at me, I go out to the side and into my thigh. See how that didn't put any bend into this horse at all. And this is a highly trained horse that knows how to bend. And that didn't put any bend into his neck at all because it doesn't have the side action. So that's a really important difference about using this type of equipment. It can be nice and soft. You can train horses to it. It can be great for teaching a horse to ride one-handed if you're going to transition them to a bit. But it's not something that I would use on a horse that is learning how to go bitless or that maybe has some behavioral issues that you're trying to overcome, I would definitely not ride my horse Zira in it. So if that wants to be like a little bit of a test of would I ride Zira in it, Zira's my horse that was given to me for being a rearer. She's kind of like, hey, my name's Zira, I like to rear. And that's pretty much what she is. So I would not ride this in that horse because I wouldn't have my side action. So if she went to rear on me, I just wouldn't have as good control to do that. And this is a very highly trained horse. This is Dreamer. He's my movie horse. He's been in 3 feature films. He's been ridden by actors like Kevin McGeary from Heartland. And he's really, really well trained. And even he doesn't understand this so well. And part of that's because I haven't trained him to it. But I like to use, if I'm going to be training a horse with behavioral issues or that's new to Bitless, I want to use something that's going to be pretty intuitive to that, meaning that they just kind of get it. All right, so that's kind of my review on a Bozzle. It can be an okay tool to use, but if you're worried about control issues, I would definitely not start with a Bozzle, and I would not start with any type of hackamore or rope hackamore that attaches under the chin so you don't have a side action. All right, so the next one I'm going to talk about is the side pull. So these are kind of my favorite options for working with horses. The action of the reins is right on the side of the bridle. The one that I have on him here is a leather side pull. The other really common type that you buy as a side pull is the rawhide one. So the big difference for why you might want one over the other, the leather one is softer on the horse's nose, so you can ride in contact better. So if you're going to be riding with a little bit of feel on your horse, this is nicer for them in terms of going into that pressure. Whereas the rawhide, that's not going to sit so nice on their hands. However, we'll use the rawhide here with our lesson horses because when we've got like little 5-year-old kids on the horses, they've got like really little weak arms. And so when they want to ask the horse to turn or to stop, even though we're teaching them about using their body and breathing out, at the end of the day, if the horse gets distracted and they're like, oh, squirrel, we don't want them sitting up there like a little light fly. We want them to be able, if they pick up the rope, we want them to be able to get the attention of the horse. So not that we want to hurt a horse, and these don't like hurt them, like we're not going around like really yanking on them, but if the horse is distracted and you've got like little people with little weak arms, then this can help give them that little bit of extra notice to the horse, whereas this is super comfortable on the horse's nose, so you still have really great communication with the horse. But if you're a really little person with really weak arms and you know you riding with loose reins, your horse might be able to ignore you more easily in this if they're distracted or something like that. So the rawhide just gives them a little bit more like, oh, I want to pay attention to that, because if you were to pull really hard, it could hurt. Not that that's our intent, but just the idea of this could get their attention a little bit more than this, because this is going to be a bit more uncomfortable when you pull. The nice thing though is as soon as you release the rein pressure, it's going to release right away. The other type of side pull that you can get is, this is the thin line bitless attachment, and this is actually something that I helped thin line design. And the neat thing about it is it's basically the same as this leather one that Dreamer's wearing here, but it is a noseband attachment that attaches to any bridle. So you can use whatever head stall you have, whether it's an English one or a Western one, you want one with beads across the brow band, whatever you want, and you just attach the thin line noseband to it, and you can use it English or Western. Ride bits and do a lot of clinics with people in bits, and I'll even ride them myself. I just think that cowboy shows, but everybody usually says, oh, well, that's only because he was trained in a bit first. So I figure he'll be my horse that I compete in with a bit to show that I can do that and I don't hate bits per se. And I don't think you're a bad person if you ride in a bit. And then my other horses that don't have the training in the bits, they're the ones that I'm going to show bitless this year. When it comes to English bridles, we often use this jumping hackamore. It's pretty common for jumpers. What makes it nice is that you have just a little bit of leverage, so when you lift up on the shank there, it closes just a little bit, but you can see that it doesn't get like super tight. It's not like the cross under style that will just kind of keep pulling and keep closing. It can only go so far with the shank. And what's nice about that is if your horse starts to get a little bit strong and maybe you're getting a little tired in competition, it just gives you that little bit of extra attention getting sort of action on the horse and helps encourage them to kind of stay under themselves a little bit more than just a simple side pull. So not that I'm advocating that you should just go to leverage or anything stronger just for the sake of brakes or getting your horse to stop or things like that, but sometimes it can be helpful. We have a lot of little kids that ride the horses here, ride our thoroughbreds, and being able to just pick up the reins and have that little bit of touch there just helps them a little bit. Also, when I was competing in Kentucky this year, just a month before Kentucky, I had a log fall on my finger and got this disgusting scar. Check this out. So that's my Frankenstein finger, as I call it now. It basically completely split open, and because that happened, I basically could not use this hand, and I was really worried. Getting out to Kentucky, I had done all of Blizz's training, this is Blizz, in just the thin line side pull, and that's what I intended to compete her in. And then after that happened to my finger, and I basically didn't have use of my left hand, it was so weak, it was so painful, I basically could not turn left. Like, I could hardly put anything on the rein at all. So I switched her into the hackamore, so that way I would just have to barely touch the rein, and you can see she was very responsive to that. So I ended up competing her in the hackamore, and then we just sort of kept her in the hackamore when we came home for the lesson students to ride her in. So if you've got a horse that you want to ride bitless and you're thinking about doing jumping, but you think that sometimes they get a little bit strong, or maybe you're a little bit on the weaker side, then this may be a good option for you. I like it because the horses seem to like it. It releases really nicely. When you give your hand to the horse, they automatically get that little release. So it's nice that way for them. And it can only close so much on them, so you're not gonna hurt your horse. I just use the leather on the bottom for the chin strap, so I don't have a chain or anything like that on my guys, and it's got the sheepskin over the nose. So it can be pretty comfortable for them, and I find they respond really nicely to it. So this is another type of side pull. This is the fusion halter that I designed. It has the trainability of the rope halter with the rope over the nose and behind the ears, but then the safety and the convenience of the leather with the rings and the ring under the chin as well. It's my favorite tool for starting horses in. Now, when we start horses, we usually ride on a loose rein and we do different maneuvers and things like that. And you might be wondering why I have the little fuzzy on her nose. And that's because I've been starting to ride her in more contact. So I've been asking her to collect a little bit more. And so I've added the little fuzzy there so that way she doesn't get little rubs on her nose. And the reason why I'm using this halter instead of switching to the thin line nose band like I normally would for collection, I'm doing that because for extreme cowboy racing that I'm training her for, doesn't allow you to show in anything where you can tie their nose shut. And because the thin line nose band adjusts, you can change the width of it on the bottom, technically you could close your horse's mouth with it, whereas a halter is fixed. So we're allowed to ride bitless in a rope halter, but not allowed to ride bitless in the thin line nose band. So even though the thin line nose band would be better for collection work and the stuff that I'm doing, because I'm training for Extreme Cowboy, I'm using this. And Peanut is the horse that I started from scratch just 2.5 months ago. She was given to me for being really aggressive. She was chasing people out of the paddock. and she had not yet been started, and they were kind of at their wits' end as to what to do with her. So I took her on, and in 11 sessions trained her to ride walk, trot, canter, all without using a crop, bit, spurs, not using even ever a whip or a stick or anything like that, because I wanted to show people, not that I think tools are bad, but I think we rely on them to make up for things that maybe the horse is scared or the horse isn't understanding or our position isn't in the right spot, whether it be on the ground or in the saddle. So I wanted to show people that it's possible to train a horse using very minimal tools. And I actually do liberty starts as well, where I don't use any tools whatsoever. But with her, I just used a halter and a rope, and then eventually added the reins and the saddle. And my goal is to train her to a level where she can compete at Worlds for extreme cowboy racing, just to show people that it is possible to train a horse to refinement without having to use a bit or spurs. Again, not that I think that those things are bad, I just think that sometimes people jump to them for the answer when there are other things that we could do to try to help the horse instead. So because I started her for scratch by myself, I am getting her to get ready for extreme cowboy for that. And if you're interested to see more about her sessions, I filmed all of her sessions to get started, which is 11 sessions under saddle. And they're all available if you hop onto my website, harmonyhorsemanship.ca, and you click become a student. You'll see the online school there, and you can see the starting from scratch series where I film all her sessions. So I hope you find that helpful to learn about all the different types of bitless versus bits and kind of why you might want to choose one or the other. I hope that helps. I'd love to hear what you're going to do. And you can check out my other video on how to get your horse started bitless if you're interested in giving it a try. So thanks for watching, guys, and bye for now.